morning. Let's stand up and worship. Welcome to Palm Sunday.
Church, you can have a seat. If this is your first time, we want to welcome you to what a beautiful Sunday, Palm Sunday. The kids came in singing Hosanna, Hosanna, and if you don't know what that means, it means they were lifting their praises. You know, this is the Holy Week. This is the week leading up to Easter, and we know how the story ends. But the people that were on the road welcoming Jesus, singing Hosanna, they didn't know how the story ended. They were shouting praises that he had come in to their city. And a few days later, they betrayed him and they said, crucify him. But today we get to celebrate what this week means to each and every one of us. And I want to read a verse from John 12, verse 13. It says, they took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel. So I just want to welcome you this beautiful Sunday. Thank you for joining us. When you could have been out on spring break or anywhere else, I want you to turn to your neighbor and say, I'm so glad you're here this morning. Awesome. So if this is your first time, we want to welcome you. We have a gift out in the foyer for you just to say welcome. If this is your second time, you are now family. So you have refrigerator privileges. We have a few announcements this week. It's a big week in the life of church. Invite your neighbors, invite your family. You want to be a part. So this week we have, I always butcher this word, so bear with me, Maundy Thursday. This is the Last Supper. This is when Jesus washed the disciples' feet. We are having a service right here at 6:30. You want to be here. You want to join us. For our youth in the room, if on Wednesday nights we are having a showing of the Passion movie, so come out and join us. It's going to be a more serious moment. It's not going to be like a fun going to the movie theater, getting popcorn. It's going to be a little bit more serious, talking about the death and resurrection of Jesus. And then next Sunday, for my early birds, we have an Easter sunrise service at the Tabernacle at 6:30. Everyone say 6:30. Awesome. And then we'll have our normal service here at 9:00 to follow. So we are going to go through a few more songs if you want to stand and join me as we worship. Thank you.
Oh, God. I see the King of glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see his love and mercy washing over.
In Psalm 40:16, it says, "May all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you. May those who love your salvation say continually, great is the Lord." The Bible talks so much about how great our God is, how great is his holiness. He is the Alpha, the Omega. He is the beginning and he is the end. And he is our great God. So let's continue worshiping and singing how great our God is.
All the earth rejoice. Amen. You may be seated. We serve a pretty good God, don't we? Amen. I'm Joseph Sager, privileged to be the lead pastor here at Santa Claus Christian Church, and glad to be in worship with you. Every Sunday, it's a little Easter, but this week, we get the real one. They're all Easters we remember, but boy, we get to walk with Jesus through what happened. So I'm a little bit excited that we get to gather several times this week, that we get to see where God leads us in our own journey through this week. We have this time now as we worship together to go before the throne together. And I'd love to hear what's on your heart, what praises you have, what concerns, where you're sensing God calling. You'd like for us to just pray for you and over you. So if you have those prayer requests, I'd love for you to raise your hand and share your name. We pray over those throughout the week. What is on your heart this morning?
Hi, this is Susan Tiefert, and I just, we had another blessing this week. Harvey Lawrence was born on Wednesday, so thank goodness for grandparents.
Praise God.
Please continue to pray for Ruby Tabbert. She had to go back to the hospital this week as she's not putting on the weight that, as fast as they'd like, so please keep the whole Tabbert family in your prayers.
I just wanted to lift up everyone traveling for spring break. There's a lot of people down there, so just travel mercies and for just everyone to be safe and make great decisions for the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Yeah, I'd like a prayer for my brother. He's got stage 3 lung cancer. He's undergoing treatment.
Lord, hear our prayers. Let's go to God.
God, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for the ways in which you just continue to pour yourself out for us. God, sometimes we wake up and we can just do nothing but just see the beauty of the day and see the ways in which spring is coming forth, new beginnings are possible. But even as those new beginnings come forth, God, sometimes we just see there's work in our own hearts. Those things that didn't go our way, or we see how we responded and we remember your love and how it's so far from what we've done. God, regardless of the day, your grace is enough. It covers us and it carries us. God, your Holy Spirit goes before us and ordains paths that we have yet to understand and comprehend. But Lord, when we are faithful, it is so good. God, I thank you for the people of Santa Claus Christian Church, for their faithfulness in worshiping and joining online as we attempt to just live life in eager expectation of your return. God, we raise up those who are hurting, those who are confused, God, especially those who are lost, who are seeking answers far, far from your cross. God, let them know that this Good Friday season still has a stone that can roll. God, we thank you for the privilege of walking through your word and seeing the life of Jesus, and especially this week, how he poured himself out for us. And so, God, we try to be faithful to all of his commands that he has given to us, including that to pray as he prayed, as we join together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses. We forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power Amen. Amen. It is indeed good to be a community rooted in Christ, grounded by faith and branching out in love. And we're doing a little literally this week as we have these beautiful decorations for Holy Week as we branch out, not just new growth, but it's a way of loving our neighbors, right? It's a way of saying, God has grounded me where I am, wherever you live, but we can reach out in ways beyond our understandings and bear fruit and cast seed in a way that gives God glory. Last week, we had a conversation about Jesus and being on the way to Jerusalem. And as you read Luke, as you read the Gospels, you see he comes up against these other forces, these other groups, these other institutions that say, no, go this way. Go a different way than what God has called us to. But the way of Jesus, the way of forgiveness, is always going to be the way against those unforgiving tribalisms that try to separate us, those deceptive philosophies that keep us from living in the reality of the resurrection. Then, as now, it can be hard to walk. And so if you're somebody who's struggling, don't wait till next Sunday to have a conversation. Look around. There's good people who have walked this journey for a long season that you can talk to, or make an appointment, and I'd love to sit with you about where you're wrestling in life and your faith, what questions you may have, because when you live in the reality of the resurrection, something beautiful happens in your life. Or maybe you just need a group. New groups will be forming here in April that you see that you're not alone in those struggles. So please, please be about that. But as Jesus was going up to Jerusalem, he arrives on Palm Sunday. And so we get to celebrate that today with Holy Week. As Sierra shared, we're gathering again on Thursday with Maundy Thursday and walking through Jesus' final night on earth at 6:30. And then over at Christ Community Church in Dale on Friday, we're joining with our brothers and sisters from around the county as we walk through that ultimate time of Jesus' death upon a cross. But we come back here for Sunday. Up there at the tabernacle and here we will celebrate. So be ready for that party. But let us pray as we go into the word today. God, there's always a lot in spring. We're getting pulled by the school calendar that tells us we need to run away and enjoy this time. And indeed we will, and many have, and God, we lift them up. But for here and now, God, wherever we are and whatever's going on, let us be present to your word and your spirit. Lord, take the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart. May they be acceptable to you, my Lord, my rock, and my redeemer. Amen. How many of you have been on a road trip? How many of you are on a road trip, right? We have a lot of people who view, and we're so grateful for you for doing that. But the reality, when you go on a road trip, you have this destination in mind. But so often, as you go through the road trip, the end doesn't seem as important as the journey, right? The conversations you have, the detours you take, and yes, even the car breaking down. Those are the stories you tell so often about where you're going. It's about how you got there and the journey that's there. But this story is about the destination. When you go read Jesus' story and his ministry before, it's all very important. But Holy Week, it's about when he arrives, what is going on. And so in Mark 11, we're going to read this version of the Passion narrative today of Palm Sunday. It says, as they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples. I'm going to pause there. We're going to pause there. On the screen, you're going to see a map about Jericho and Bethany. And so you'll be able to see where things are, just to give you an idea. So on the left, there's a map of, this doesn't really show up. There it is. So up here is the Sea of Galilee. Right here is where a lot of Jesus' ministry happened. Here, this white part is Samaria. So they'd all come down through this valley. You can see all the hills, the wilderness, etc. They come through this valley and then up to Jerusalem right here. Here's Jericho. It's right here at the north end of the Dead Sea. It's the lowest city on earth still to this day. And you have to ascend up to Jerusalem on the Jericho Road. And once they got there, before they got there, they stayed in Bethany over here, And so Bethany is just on the east side of Jerusalem, and they went up to Bethpage, and they got a donkey. We're going to read about that. And they came through the Kidron Valley and into the temple through the eastern gate. And that just gives you an idea of the geography of what was going on with Jesus. And so he traveled a long distance, staying most likely with Mary and Martha and Lazarus over there, and Bethpage and Bethany. But as we start to go through, we see that he meets a lot of people here on Holy Week. And a question I want you to be thinking about this week is, how do we meet Jesus? How have we encountered him? How do we prepare to receive Jesus? And how do we respond when he shows up? Now, many of you can maybe think back and testify about that time when Jesus met you in a dark spot or on a mountaintop, or your life was going one way, you encountered Jesus and you went another. And amen. Let's talk about it. We need to hear those stories about Jesus showing up and changing lives, because he's still doing it today. Some of us are yearning for him to do it again. One way to maybe think about this and maybe to practice you can put into place is, as you go back and read the Gospels, to imagine yourself in that story. Read it and then be like, who was I? Was I viewing it from up top as an ethereal being, an omnipotent narrator? Was I in the crowd watching it go by? Was I the person Jesus was talking to? And when you do that, you realize that in your heart, the gospel is working on you still. The gospel continues to work on us. As we're honest, and this is something only you can do, is you check your heart. What emotions am I feeling? What disconnect do I have? Where am I leaning in? Where can I not read past because if something is welling up inside? When we read the Gospels and we start putting ourselves in the story so often, we can see the ways in which Jesus continues to minister to us. Now, the reality is God is always with us, Emmanuel, right? Jesus, for those of us who have already called him Lord and accepted his work for us, and we follow what he says, his Holy Spirit resides within, but the reality is, like Peter, we can go astray. And then just hear that beautiful sound of his voice calling us from the seashore, of restoring us with his love. And realize whatever walk we're in, the voice of Jesus is what we need to hear. And so as we read this encounter with Jesus, on the next slide you'll see this depiction of what some think about. But in verse 2, if you join with me, Jesus was speaking to his disciples. Jesus said to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If there is anyone who asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' tell him, 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here shortly.'" Let's just pause for a second. Does anyone find that extremely strange? Let me try it again. Imagine someone, you were out in the parking lot, Jesus meets you, and he says, "Hey, go inside of Santa Claus Christian Church. In the third pew, you're going to find someone's keys. Just grab it. Take it out." And if they say, "Hey, why are you stealing my car?" you'd be like, "The Lord needs it." It's strange. It's an utterly bizarre thing, but at the time, there was this fervent expectation of the Messiah showing up, and so the disciples have stopped asking some questions at this point. They're like, "He's done it before." You remember the fish and the loaves? Like, crazy things happen when Jesus is around, and we say yes to what he says to us. Good things can continue to happen. And guess what? In verse 4 to 7, it happens. They went out and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, "What are you doing untying that colt?" They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. That's what happens. I wish sometimes Scripture would talk about those other people when they saw it happen, like, "What are you doing?" And what they said when they went back, like, hey, what happened to your donkey? The Lord needed it. Right? It made sense a little bit later when Jesus came through and was like, yeah, that's my donkey. Right? Riding along. And so, but why is it in Scripture what we do have? It's a rather odd story to talk about Jesus' hooves or wheels, we would say today, right? Like, why does that matter? Have you ever wondered, like, when you read the Bible more and more and more, you need to start asking, why is this not in here? Right? Like, they'll go hundreds of years and not say a word, and then it'll take like 15 minutes and take up like four pages. What is God doing with his word that says, hey, this is really important how Jesus entered into Jerusalem? Well, for one thing, it's the fulfillment of prophecy. So if you have these little notes in your Bible, or if you've been reading through your Bible a bunch of times, as you see this, you start to see that, oh, wow, this happened before. You see, Zechariah was a prophet in the 6th century BC, and he was a prophet around 520 to 518. He was a prophet after the fall of Jerusalem. Jesus is going to Jerusalem. Jerusalem fell and all the exiles had left. And at 538, people were starting to go back. If you go read about King Cyrus and what he was doing and sending them back. And in 520, Zechariah begins his ministry. From 520 to 518, he has these visions about what the people should do. This is when they're rebuilding the temple with Haggai. He's doing it under King Darius. The same King Darius who threw Daniel into a lion's den, right? And so just to give you historical reference, what was going on in that time, Daniel's back in Babylon, but some people have left and they're rebuilding the temple. So there's a lot of conversation about where is God in this? How do we worship a God who was in a temple, but it was burned to the ground and now they're rebuilding it for God's glory to return there? And so Zechariah says many things if you go and read his prophecy. But in verses 9 to 11, we read there, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim, and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will free your prisoners from the waterless pit." Do you hear the gospel there? A king coming to proclaim peace. By his blood, people are freed from their chains. It's all crystal clear when we see it through the lens of the open tomb. But this was before Good Friday. This was a people who all they saw was Rome being tyrannically oppressing them. And so they're pretty excited that somebody who's been doing wonder workers, someone who some are saying might be the Messiah, is coming up to Jerusalem to return Jerusalem to its former glory. And so they are excited. They lay out the ancient red carpet and they get out their cell phones to take selfies with the one who's coming. All glory, laud, and honor, right? If you go to anything today, how do we do it? That's how we do it then. They put their cloaks on the ground and they raised up their palm branches. Palms, the sign of victory. Palms, the sign of kings. And so if we go back to the scripture there in Mark, we hear them saying it. "Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest.'" Hosanna! It is a song of praise, but literally what it meant was, "Save us." You see, they were looking around at what Jerusalem was at the time and how Rome had this control, and they were like, "We don't want this. Please, Messiah, save us. You are our king." How do we sing to God when he draws near? What songs do we sing? Do you pay attention to the lyrics on Sunday morning, to the worship songs we sing? What about throughout the week, the songs you sing? Yes, not just Christian praise, but the rest of them. What songs are we singing? What are we worshiping? Because a lot of times songs are just fun, but when you pay attention to the lyrics, we're telling a message about the way we should live. What words are we saying? What does it mean when we sing out to our King? Verse 11 seems a little bit anticlimactic, especially when you read the other Gospels and what happens. But Mark says, Jesus entered Jerusalem, went to the temple. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. And so he returned. But what else is going on here? You see, like I said, there's a lot happening in the white spaces of Scripture. And so on this next slide, I want to show you a model of Jerusalem in Jesus' day. This is, if you ever get to go to Israel, this is a model that they have there. And this is from the point of view from the Mount of Olives. From Bethpage, as you're coming over through the Kidron Valley up to the Temple Mount on the east side. And so what you see here, there it is. And so this is the Temple Mount, how they imagined it. Again, archaeology constantly changes things. You have the Pool of Bethesda over here. You have all sorts of things happening, and there's wonderful stories all around. But I want you to focus on this up to the right, this little fortress. That's called the Antonia Fortress. It was believed that Rome built that there so that at times of festivals, they could look down over the temple and make sure there wasn't an uprising happening. In fact, we have evidence in Scripture that at the times of these festivals, Pilate would come into town, and he actually brutally murdered people. He was known as this brutal ruling force of the Palestinian area. But as they're approaching this festival of Passover, which was going to happen that next week, you have to remember that Jerusalem was a city of about 20 to 30,000 people. And estimates are that throughout the time of Passover, there would have been about 150,000 people there every day. Five to 10 times. And they say over 2.5 million people over the whole time to offer their sacrificing could have passed through Jerusalem. And so Jesus is coming in. It's not just the people who were there. It's everybody descending on Jerusalem saying, our Messiah is coming. A Messiah is the anointed one. David was a Messiah, and an anointed one who's someone who raises up the sword and takes on the powers. And so you can imagine from the other side up here, from the west, there's a different procession coming to make sure that doesn't happen. You see, Pilate would have been in Caesarea Maritima, which is on the Mediterranean Sea. And at this time, he would have been coming. And if he came, he would have had steeds, war horses. He would have had the army before and after him demanding people to listen to the good news of Augustus Caesar, that they are coming to bring the Pax Romana, the peace of Rome, to this situation. And so in Jerusalem, you have these two very different approaches. The humble king on the donkey with the people saying, hey, rise up. And the conquering ruler who's saying, demanding their attention. Both of them would have had people lining the streets. Neither of them really knew what was going on. In between, you have the Sanhedrin, which would have been on the teaching stairs on the south end over here, over to the left on this picture. And they're the ones in the other Gospels that say, hey, control these people. And Jesus says, hey, even the stones would cry out if they don't speak. We are fulfilling prophecy here. There's different visions of what the king should be. Have you thought about King Jesus lately? We're going to Good Friday. We talk about Jesus dead on a cross, doing that work for us, but is he Lord in your life? Or is he somebody that we lean on when we talk about where we're going after we die? It's not that one is true in the other, but what Jesus is approaching here is that he is king, that he is the Messiah. Because when we go out these doors and people see you as a Christian, they look at you and they're like, is that who Jesus is? Do we go around as conquering kings, as people who demand other people get in line because we're right, we're smart, superior, and saved? Or do we go humbly, weeping as Jesus wept because he knew that the people did not understand? He knew that many would be left out of the grace that he was offering because they would refuse. And so how do we go in 5 days from Hosanna to crucify him? Well, let's look back at Zechariah and you'll see why people may have had such blinders on. In verses 12 to 15, it says, hear the military language. Return to your fortress, O prisoners of hope. Even now I announce that I will restore twice as much to you. I will bend Judah as I bend my bow and fill it with Ephraim. I will rouse your sons, O Zion, against your sons, O Greece, and make you like a warrior's sword. Then the Lord will appear over them. His arrow will flash like lightning. The sovereign Lord will sound the trumpet, and he will march in the storms of the south, and the Lord Almighty will shield them. They will destroy and overcome with sling stones. They will drink and roar as with wine. They will be like a bowl used for the sprinkling the corners of the altar. See, you can see whenever a good student of Torah, a good student of the Hebrew scriptures would have said, hey, when they come in on a donkey, there's going to be a reckoning. In fact, the altar will be covered in blood. A lot of people believed it would be a re-sanctifying of the temple of what was going on. But through the lens of the empty tomb, we know of a different sacrifice that happened. They wanted a ruler and a conquering king, so they didn't have ears to hear and eyes to see the suffering servant that Jesus was. How he wanted all to come to him. Not just Israel, not just Judah, not just the Pharisees or the Sadducees, but all. A light was shining to the Gentiles just as Jesus was drawing all the tribes to himself. You see, they misunderstood who Jesus was in that time. And so when they quoted Psalm 118, they kind of quoted it out of context. That's the song they were singing. How do we understand Jesus? A side note, forgot to put the slide up there, so please go look at this. We're not the only ones who misunderstand this. You know, what happened after this whole time period, Jerusalem falls, Rome rules, and then there's this period of different people taking over. The Christians have it, and then the Muslims rise up in the 600s, and they take over Israel. And back and forth in the Crusades they go, and after the Crusades, there was this ruler by the name of Suleiman. And he was reading the Jewish scriptures, and in Ezekiel 44, there's this prophecy that the Spirit of the Lord left through the eastern gate and would return to bring his Shekinah glory to the temple and reclaim the land for himself, that God would come through the eastern gate and take over. And so Suleiman did what any responsible ruler did. He sealed the gate. And they started burying Muslims in front of the gate so that it would never be reopened. It's just unfortunate he didn't know fully who Jesus was, because our king had already entered. So here now, Psalm 118, the psalm that kind of sits at the middle of it all and literally is the middle chapter in the Bible. That's just an aside. Psalm 118 says, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his love endures forever. How long does his love endure? Forever. That's something we can sing every day ourselves, but you can hear how the people of the time would have really had this as a rallying cry whenever they felt far from God's favor as Rome was still ruling. In verse 5, it says, in my anguish I cried to the Lord, and he answered by setting me free. The Lord is with me. What do we read in Matthew? Emmanuel. Emmanuel. God with us. The Lord is with me. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? The Lord is with me. He is my helper. I will look in triumph on my enemies. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes. And you can see why Psalm 118 would have been on the forefront of their minds, yearning for God to show up in a new way. And in verses 10 to 21, you see this hope. All the nations surrounded me, but in the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me on every side, but in the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They swarmed around me like bees, but they died out as quickly as burning thorns. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. I was pushed back and about to fall, but the Lord helped me. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. Shouts of joy and victory resound in the tents of the righteous. The Lord's right hand has done many things. The Lord's right hand is lifted high. The Lord's right hand has done many things. I will not die but live and will proclaim what the Lord has done. The Lord has chastened me severely, but he has not given me to death. Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. So Jesus comes up, the one who can conquer the nations to enter in to the gates for them to give thanks. You can see where they're at. And then there's this subtle discordant note in verse 22. The stone the builders rejected has become the capstone. What does that mean? If you read your Gospels, you'll see that in almost every one of them, Jesus uses this scripture as one of his main teachings to talk about how Israel rejected the tree of God. We talk about the branch of Jesse, and in Isaiah 5, there's this vineyard where Judah is sprouting forth, and it gets cut off. But it sprouts anew. This hope of the Messiah coming forth. And Jesus talks about this vineyard and how the walls are torn over because, not of Rome, but the leaders, the Sadducees, the Pharisees, the Jewish people themselves, not understanding who Jesus is. So when you get home today, go read Mark 12, 1 through 12, and you'll see how Jesus points out their complete misunderstanding of Psalm 118. In that passage. Verses 23 and 24 go on. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And then we enter into their song. O Lord, save us. O Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord we bless you. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine upon us. With bows in hand, join in the festal procession up to the horns of the altar. Did you hear Hosanna there? No, because we translate it in the English. It says, Lord Hosanna, Lord save us. But that brings something up. What did the people on the street say? They said, save us. They didn't say, Lord, save us. Now, this could just be me looking in at something, but it struck me profound as I was preparing for this. They wanted saved. They wanted a king who would save them. They didn't care who it was. They just wanted to get out from the rule. If you go back and look through Jesus' life on his way up to Jerusalem, so often as people encountered God, Jesus asked them questions to reveal what's in their hearts. And so often, so many of them just wanted a miracle maker for their own end. They wanted a Messiah so they could have their privileged place in society. They didn't want a Lord who would tell them how to live, how to be, because they wanted Lord for themselves. And again through this psalm, it says, Lord. It says, Lord. It says, Lord, save us. And they go to the altar, the horns of the altar. You see, the altar was in front of the Temple Mount. It was where they took the sacrifice and stuck it there to finish the sacrifice. They're saying it and they don't understand it. They're bringing in the sacrificial lamb to be put on an altar. Their lack of understanding is part of why they did not understand what they were saying when they said, crucify him. They didn't understand that this road went to the cross. See, the reality is God was willing to be broken for his people. He was willing to be broken for his enemies, for his captors. He's willing to be broken for us. As I said in Luke, it talks about how he weeps for those who do not yet understand. And my question for us today is, where are our hearts as we think about Jesus drawing near? Do we weep for those who have no understanding of the grace and the love that they can have in Jesus? That there are many, just like then in Jerusalem, who draw near, who say they know God, but they are not saying, Lord, Master, your sacrifice and all that you are, I want it to be mine. As the song said, break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I am for your kingdom come. Do we want Jesus for Sunday morning? Do we want Jesus for when we die? Or do we want Jesus for every day to walk with us, to guide us, so that we can sing, Lord, save us, and sing it as a praise with the full reality of what's to come on Good Friday and the glorious morning of the resurrection? Psalm 118 finishes out this way. You are my God, and I will give you thanks. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let us pray. God, we thank you for this journey of life. So many fun stories. But God, we've gotten ourselves into some positions where we thought we knew where we were going. And so God, we thank you for your grace. God, for any who does not understand who Jesus really was, God, break our hearts. May we be your hands and feet and maybe purveyors of the gospel. For any who are loving you, Jesus, only as the king who can conquer other people, God, may their hearts be broken and see that you rule our hearts as well. For any who may have denied you, Lord, and are far like Peter, may they hear your voice sweetly, calling your people back to yourself. God, we thank you for sending your son Jesus to walk this road. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We have a journey before us this week, but it is worth walking because our God is good. And all the time. Amen. Go forth in grace and peace.